On today's program, we will hear about a faith-based non-for-profit organization that focuses on housing, education, and economic development in the community. Their goal is not to fix people or solve their problems, but to empower them through God's love to recognize one another's gifts, talents, and experiences, and to work to enhance each person's responsibility and potential. Stay tuned.
Show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level. If you'll open up the door, he wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for.
If you're looking for contentment in the things that you can see, you're gonna have some disappointment. So won't you listen to me, please?
'Cause I know about a savior. Came down to be a man,
and when he left, he sent his spirit. He made me everything I am.
He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. What he came down for.
Sometimes I make decisions that later I regret, but the Lord keeps on assuring me
he's not finished with me yet. I don't worry about tomorrow.
I don't worry about yesterday. I don't worry about this crazy world, 'cause I found a better way.
When I couldn't get up to his, with a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. Came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for.
He wants to make your life worth living.
That's what he came down for. That's what he came down for.
Hello and welcome to Everlasting Love. We're so thankful that you could join us. We hope that you enjoyed the music at the beginning of the program. Today, we're going to be talking with Shona Miranda, and Nora Wilburn, two partners that work with Good News Partners Ministry. It's a ministry that's helping to end homelessness in our city. But before we do that, I just wanted to invite you guys that if any of you ever need prayer, if you ever need someone to talk to, if you ever want any more questions answered about something you saw on the show, please don't hesitate to call us. Our number is 773-286-2171. We also have a YouTube program, a YouTube channel, that if any of the things you saw you enjoyed and you want to watch more, you can go to that channel and see it also. But I wanted to introduce you guys to Shona Miranda, the Program Director of Outreach and Partnerships, and Ms. Nora Wilburn, the chaplain at Good News Partners. Thank you, ladies, so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having us.
Yes. So we always like to start the program just asking you about your personal journey with Jesus. How did that come about? Nora, since you're a chaplain, we would love to start with you.
Well, I guess I would be the second generation of ministers in my family.
Oh, wow.
I grew up, my mom and dad were both pastors of a church on the south side of Chicago. So I grew up in that home and them evangelizing me as a child. And
right.
One of the gifts was the ability to sing. And so I did a lot
wow.
of that and teaching Sunday school and things like that. But it was never in my view that I would be preaching,
right?
Because it's such an awesome, growing up in a pastor's house, you see the responsibility and the love and the outpouring, and I didn't think that that was necessarily for me, not because
right.
I didn't love God, but I knew that he had other ways for me to witness for him and
mm-hmm.
Be a light for him. But after my parents, my father passed on their 51st year wedding anniversary, and then my mom passed 8 months later. And it was after that that I actually accepted the call to preach. So it was a journey getting
mm-hmm.
there,
mm-hmm.
but God had always, I'd always loved the word
right.
of God, always felt connected and very much loved by God, and grew up in a community with my parents really showing love to everyone.
Right.
So that's kind of how my journey started as a believer in Christ. So as a child being evangelized, and knowing the love of God, and then growing up and being able to serve him by being witnessed by my parents in their love of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, I did have a question for you. Sometimes,
sure.
I think as children you can, you know, say the prayer and do all that, but
mm-hmm.
sometimes you don't become a follower of Christ,
mm-hmm.
an actual like Christian follower, until later.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have a moment like that, or were you always really just growing up and learning and developing in your faith, or did you have like a time when you actually, it was more of a decision of your own?
I would say that it was always there.
Mm-hmm.
And my parents, I went, especially my father, I went around as he did ministry to the seniors and throughout, so I was always introduced or being shown how God works in the life of people.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't until my college years that I had a real crisis of faith. And so being introduced to different religions and different people and different ideas,
mm-hmm.
then it really made me question, well, what do I believe?
Mm-hmm.
And which was a good thing, because
right.
then it made me stronger in my faith, and I really experienced the connection of the personal Jesus that
mm-hmm.
is my personal savior. So it wasn't just
okay.
on the family plan.
Right.
It was definitely, you know, an individual journey, and even having a situation where I had walked away from God because I didn't like his authority
right.
and deciding that I could do better on
mm-hmm.
my own. And because most of my life I had been walking with God to my best understanding and loving him to the best that I knew at the time, having that void that happened in my life when I wasn't connected, actively connected to him, it was such a devastating place.
Mm-hmm.
But his love called me back. And when I came back, I never, ever want to experience that absence from God again. So that falling away for a season was beneficial to me in the long run, and even in getting to the place of knowing that it's not, that it really, I feel like when Jesus said, you know, not my will, but thy will be done,
right.
You know, so that consistent surrendering that we do as a believer, as a child of God, but then that second step of becoming a preacher, which is such an awesome responsibility.
Right.
It took the same surrendering and knowing that I in and of myself, I can do nothing, but it's only through him mm-hmm. that I'm able to do it. And I do it to the best of my ability, knowing that he does the heavy lifting.
So. Yeah. Well, that's amazing. I think college is it's a turning point for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. It can turn people away because they've never, I think as much as people try to prepare their children, they forget that there are other religions and viewpoints, and that that's also something you want to talk to them about, because they get to college and they just become bombarded. There's mm-hmm. just so much and so many different people, and they all kind of seem right.
Right.
So
right.
It's right. It's a critical point in a lot of people's lives, I think. Well, Ms. Peronda, what about your story? How did you come to not only know the Lord, but really start serving him?
I had grown up in a Christian family as well. Mm-hmm. And I had a very strong influence upon my life from both my grandparents, my maternal grandparents, and then the times that we would visit my paternal grandparents, who happened to be Anglican. My grandfather was a teacher, but he was also an Anglican priest.
Oh, okay.
And so we sort of vacillated between, you know, religions, depending where we were.
Okay.
You know, and I spent more time, a great amount of time with my maternal grandparents. And so they were Methodist minister. My grandmother she wasn't ordained in the Methodist ministry at the time in that faith. They didn't have women ministers, but she was in within her own right a leader,
okay.
you know, for women, and held Bible studies, and I would go with her. And so I learned more of liturgy from her, and more than hanging out with children in Sunday school, I sort of tagged along with her in
okay.
most of the women's conferences and women's, Methodist ministerial conventions
mm-hmm.
and that sort of thing. And so I think that I felt like one of the older ladies always, you know, growing up when I was with her.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a strong influence. And of course, you know, going to Catholic churches.
Okay.
There was that influence too, because we didn't have a choice. When we were at school, we had to go to Mass.
Right.
And we had to, you know, recite, obviously, the Lord's Prayer and
right.
do the Rosary. So there's all of these, sort of dynamic, you know,
mm-hmm.
influences upon my life on from a religious. Then, of course, when I got to college, normal college students do, you explore, you
right.
know, different philosophies, different belief systems, and I no longer had a support system. Mind you, I'd come all the way 10,000 miles away from home to the United States. So
where's
I didn't
your
have
home?
The home was, British by birth, you know, and
mm-hmm.
I spent we moved to Africa, Zimbabwe, and lived in South Africa. Then Zimbabwe was called Rhodesia. And so I spent 10 years of my life in Africa, you know,
oh, wow.
so, you know, across three continents, I would say, you know, the United Kingdom, Africa, and now the United States for about half my life now.
Wow.
And so it's really, yeah, it's been a journey. And
yeah.
What impacted me the most, and as I explored all these different faiths, you know, having a friend who was Hebrew, we had the Black Hebrew, we had the Jew, we had the Muslim,
mm-hmm.
all, you know, very part of my either, you know, sorority, which, you know, I joined because I thought that was the American thing to do. So all of that, you know, in college and the influences. And of course, what college student doesn't, you know, go and, you know, I participated in sort of campers, crusade type activities mm-hmm. every now and again because of my host family mm-hmm. who are very dear and wonderful and wanted me to sort of steer me always on the straight path. Mm-hmm. And apart from that, I still, you know, strayed and went to parties. I don't know to what extent that can be considered straying, but right. I did explore what I thought was the American lifestyle, and, mm-hmm. you know, go out to clubs and then come back. What one thing that I knew was so meaningful to me was it doesn't matter if we came home after going to the club to 2 o'clock in the morning, going to breakfast and then getting back to the dorm at 6 o'clock in the morning, I still made sure that I took a shower, got dressed, and went to church. Mm-hmm. And so that was very important to me coming, you know, that I didn't know until I was on my own how great the influence and impactful Christianity, you know, the Christian walk was upon my life. And half the time I probably slept in church, but, but I felt the most at peace there. Mm-hmm. And you know, and I graduated and moved to Chicago mm-hmm. as, you know, when I would go just to different churches, whatever was closest to me. Mm-hmm. And it was a bit of a cultural adjustment as well. Mm-hmm. So I got together with other women. I joined a Bible study, women of different faiths, mm-hmm. and that really helped my walk. You know, and then for the first time, I went to a non-denominational church. Mm-hmm. And through that, I think I experienced, you know, a lot more of, you know, the diversity in faith. You mm-hmm. know, the, mm-hmm. you know, freedom to worship and to, right. To dance and, you know, different forms of, you know, worship nonetheless. Right. And you know, I would say I found a balance, but in the late 90s, after. When I was reflecting and exploring what would be the best way to raise my children mm-hmm. After I got married was to, you know, just to make sure that I was in a church. It didn't matter whether or not it was denominational, but I wanted to be where I could serve. That was always my prayer, and mm-hmm. a church where, you know, there was a strong children's ministry. And but church was the home to me. I came to understand that in early in my marriage, that church was the home. So mm-hmm. when times that I had small children and I couldn't go to church, we had church at home, you know, right? Because trying to get little children together and get them, you know, get to church on time was rather difficult sometimes.
Right.
And by the time I got ready, church was halfway over. So we learned to read the Bible, sing the songs. I remember being taught at a young age.
Oh, that's really sweet. Right,
read the Bible, pray every day, and Jesus loves you, okay. and all that.
So it sounds like you had a strong foundation, and then in college you kind of learned how important it was to you.
Right. And stuff like that. It was more ritualistic, I have to admit, in during my college days. Mm. Right. And but it I reconciled again, I would say, in the late 90s, or mm-hmm. mid to late 90s, and found, you know, began my personal relationship with God. And mm-hmm. The nice thing is He's always waiting. He's always looking towards us,
yeah.
you know, whenever, you know, we answer the call to come and really develop that personal relationship. And I'd say for the first time in, I think around 1994, mm-hmm. I did.
Yeah.
All right.
Always exciting. So you guys both talked about, like, your personal walks and how important church was and things like that, and you specifically talked about serving. Mm-hmm. So we're here because both of you serve in a ministry called the Good News Partners. Mm-hmm. Can you guys just tell us and our viewers a little bit about exactly what is this ministry and what does it do?
Sure. So Good News Partners was started on Northwestern's campus with mm-hmm. Bud Ogle, who's the founder of the organization. He was also the chaplain for Northwestern at the time, and students who were a part of his group were wondering, well, you know, why did Jesus talk to the poor or address the poor more than, say, what we would be, the most of the Northwestern students would be considered more financially well-resourced, mm-hmm. so as opposed to hanging out with the Pharisees and the Sadducees mm-hmm. of his time. Mm-hmm. And so they really wanted to explore how can the church be the church. Mm-hmm. And so Good News Partners was founded out of those students really wanted a deeper walk with Christ mm-hmm. and wanted to be connected and not have their resources block them or hinder them from seeing mm-hmm. the gospel and mm-hmm. from seeing that the people who may be less resourced are no less important to God. And mm-hmm. so how they could be instrumental in impacting lives as the church. Mm-hmm. And so what they did is they came down to the north of Howard area in Rogers Park mm-hmm. Of Chicago, and they started with, they came in and they would, first they just set up prayer. Mm-hmm. They just prayed in the area. They were committed to praying for that area because at that time it was called the jungle. So it was very, very crime-ridden and a lot of homeless people. Right. And they just really prayed. And then they started with the students, they were children. They started with children in the area, and they would ask them about their lives. And then they would type up their stories, and then they would go, they would bring it back to the child and say, now you're an author, this is your story. Oh, and so wow. they kind of started with evangelizing the children, okay. but the purpose was really to see how to be an impact in that community. And so some of the students moved into the community mm-hmm. and began to take in people who were homeless. And it really was a faith journey completely because they didn't know, right. they were just being led. And Bud and others who helped along that time felt that, well, how can the church be the church? Well, some people said, well, there should be no one among us who's homeless. Well,
right.
Then there are other people who felt like, well, there needs to be a church where we can fellowship. And others felt, well, there needs to be something for the children. And so all these different, there were several ministries that started at the same time. Mm-hmm. And Good News Partners was one of them. And with our mission, which is to end homelessness and hopelessness and all that God brings to us, to foster justice and to build bridges of reconciliation. Mm-hmm. And so we do that primarily by housing. And we have a four-tier approach to end homelessness, which would be, we have a women and children shelter, new life, interim housing. Okay. And then we have a 56-unit single-room occupancy hotel called the Jonquil Hotel. And then we have co-op buildings, and we have below-market rate rental units. And so all of those are ways in which to do the first part, which is to end homelessness. Mm-hmm. And then we also then go into the other areas of ending hopelessness and build bridges of reconciliation and foster justice.
So when you said you said you have a shelter for women and children, mm-hmm. A hotel?
The Jonquil Hotel.
And how?
Single room occupancy.
Single room occupancy hotel. So mm-hmm. I think it's like 8 foot by 14 foot room. It used to be an old hotel, mm-hmm. and they were able to purchase it, and they had to clean it out first. There were people who were, it was almost like a brothel type situation, and
wow.
they went in. It's a whole miracle story, is what God did, and even being able to turn that hotel over from being a place that was sin-ridden completely to a place where the redeemed are living and growing and still seeking to get closer to God or to get closer in community. So it's a totally transformed building from what it was.
So what year did Good News Partners start?
1965, so we're actually in our 40th year.
Oh, okay, wow. Now.
So we've mm-hmm. been around this for 40 years.
Ministry. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's really exciting. So how does the hotel part work? And then could you go into like the co-op in a little bit, like how those things work?
Sure. So the first entryway to get into Good News Partners generally is with Women and Children Shelter New Life, which Ms. Miranda will talk more about that, I'm mm-hmm. sure. And then the single room occupancy hotel is for people who have some form of income, mm-hmm. be they veterans or college students. We have some college students or individuals, single people or families mm-hmm. who have some income, who are able to then pay for that unit, and the rest of the cost of it is subsidized by our ability to raise funds for that. But it's really providing housing at a amount that's reasonable for people who have low, very low means to provide for themselves. But it is also a way for those individuals to grow in community too.
When you say grow in community, like, do they have like community activities? Is this
so?
Like,
because it's a 56 unit building, people are free to go and come as they choose.
Right.
However, there are different activities that happen there. We have a adult art director who's worked with us. We have, of course, chaplaincy services are available to individuals. We have just a lot of different opportunities for people who, even if they're living there, they develop relationships among themselves too, as well as then with us as staff and with our donor partners. So when we say community, we're intentional about building a Christian community. Now, you don't have to be a Christian to be a part of, to have housing with us, but we are intentional about sharing the love of Christ and modeling that and being concerned about our neighbors and seeing how we can impact the community overall.
Okay, and you said there's a co-op. What is that part of it?
So the co-ops are, instead of, like with a condominium,
right,
you purchase your own unit and
right,
you're responsible for your unit. Co-ops are where every person in the building has a piece of the building.
Okay.
And we use that as a way, too, to help people who are seeking at some point to say they pay their amount every month,
right,
and a percentage of that goes into when they decide to leave or move, they're able to take that and can use that for as a down payment for their own home or
right,
maybe to go to school, those type of things. And it is a way to help people so that even as they're paying their taxes, they get the tax benefit of owning a piece of that building. So it's another way to redistribute wealth.
Oh, that's really cool. And is this, are these buildings in Rogers Park?
All of our buildings are in the north of Howard area. So they're between, they're west of Sheridan and south of Jonquil Terrace. And I got south and west. So it's all in a very small area, but we have 10 buildings total, so we try to keep close. And we want to have that fingerprint in that area because that area, like I said, 45 years ago, it was 40 years ago, it was a lot of poor and homeless people there. And as the area has become gentrified, then there's been an effort by many to kick the poor out of that area. So our commitment has been that we will maintain a footprint in that area so that God's people who may not be as financially well resourced have a place where they can live too, and it's within their means to afford.
Oh, that's really cool. That's really an amazing ministry. Ms. Shumney, you said, well, Nora said that you also, you work with the shelter for women and children. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Right, and what we try to do is help bring families who have needs and who are experiencing homelessness to stability in their lives and, you know, provide service needs that they have. And as Nora said, in the shelter, we have a three-tier sort of approach to, you know, helping them come to self-sufficiency. One which is providing a roof over their heads and, you know, three basic meals a day. And that's, those are the short-term needs for anybody experiencing homelessness,
right,
both chronically or just, you know, homelessness as it's sort of termed by homelessness data reports. Roofless. Roofless means that you may have a shed or a tent or a car to live in, and sometimes with friends or family, but nevertheless you're still homeless because you don't have your own sort of safety place to go. So part of the needs is safety, which is the immediate need.
Right.
And, you know, which is what we provide. We have a 36-bed shelter. and with room for emergencies, which we need every so often, because either during winter times, we may have a winter storm and people just come off the street,
right.
And we are equipped to house maybe a few more, at least up to about 10 more people.
Okay.
And we make do with whatever we have. We have little cots that we provide for those that are in crisis. We can have a woman that has been just experienced physical abuse, sexual abuse, who just shows up at the door, and we have to, even though we're not categorized as a domestic violence shelter, but we are a shelter that provides for women and children. And lately, because we have received some public funds, we now try to keep the family intact. But the whole purpose is not to provide on the short-term basic plan, but the second tier is just to have an ongoing support, is to act as an ongoing support network for them. And the third is, the third tier would be the lifelong, continuum of care, which we're committed to for at least a year, depending on how well they're doing. We're certainly trying to prevent recurring homelessness.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes that may be years after that we're still caring for them in, with the scarce resources that we have.
So,
in addition to, the roof over mm-hmm. the head and meals, we do we do a lot of program.
Okay.
When I was the program director, we did, we made sure that, and we still do have programs for the women to provide and to serve them in whatever their needs are. Through case management,
okay.
we assess their needs, both social or mental health, trauma, mm-hmm. whatever it is that they need, and then through the linkage agreements, because we can only do so much, and a case manager's sometimes not equipped to do intensive therapy mm-hmm. or counseling. And
yeah.
so we have linkage agreements that so far provide for the women through social service agencies.
Okay, so a linkage agreement is like another organization partnering alongside your organization.
Absolutely,
to help
where we can refer, okay. outsource counseling, for example,
mm-hmm.
to women and children,
mm-hmm.
and try to provide a safe, stable environment,
mm-hmm.
an environment that that they can grow and nurture, because we're faith-based. We're focused on nurturing their their Christian walk,
right.
and also introducing Christ to them,
mm-hmm.
and not just and also what sets us apart is that we're not just a shelter that provides basic social needs and service needs, but also and an environment where to sleep. That environment also has to give them, we want to ensure that they have the social connections,
mm-hmm.
because some of them have been, far removed from their families, and, mm-hmm. If they've experienced abuse or molestation,
mm-hmm.
there's sometimes overwhelming insecurities, there's sometimes manifestations of, in different behavioral patterns.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want first and foremost to make sure that they feel secure and
right.
safe, that they feel loved, and they know that they count.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go on to the other needs that they have, to provide, education, and try to help them find jobs. One of the programs we run, and collaborate with other, programs within Good News Partners, is workforce development.
Mm.
So we've been trying to expand more with that, with, again, limited resources.
Mm.
But that are some of the job opportunities and objectives that we have.
Okay, that's good.
And to that point, also, Good News Partners is also an employer.
Mm-hmm.
The
okay.
majority of our staff are employed by most of them are residents of one of our buildings, so they're not only resident partners, but they're also staff partners.
Okay.
And so for those who, so it's about 40 people on staff, and then we also employ like another 30 individuals who work for rent credit. So they may not have enough funds to cover their rent, but they work off as a cooperation among them, or sweat equity. And they do various jobs to make up the difference in what their rent would be and what they're able to provide.
So they always feel like it's not just given to them, they're helping and doing something for this.
Absolutely.
Too. Right, right. We follow, our approach is the ABCD model, which I think is, if you've heard of it, it was made more popularized by Michelle Obama when she was at the University of Chicago. But it's the asset-based community development. As community developers, we try to focus a lot on using the assets that that they, you know, our partners, and we don't call them residents, but you know, we may sometimes refer to them as residents, but these are all our partners, including all our volunteers, including the donors, because we use the same approach to everyone in terms of the goal of, you know, bringing Christ to them. So if one, for example, is just a donor, you know, and faithful and generous in, you know, contributing on a yearly basis or however, regularity or periodically that they do, we try to make sure that we engage them, you know, on a more holistic level, not just, you know, thank you for the donation and then see them the next time and send out three thank you letters to follow that. But we try to engage them to come in and get to know, you know, so education is a big part of it because we want them to be educated and feel in participate in our dinners, volunteer appreciation dinners, annual dinners, you know, which are mainly for fundraising, but to offer an opportunity to interact with the people that they're, you know, would otherwise not have an opportunity to interact with, because one in every three families that are in the neighborhood, even though it's integrated, it's quite integrated now, is living at poverty level. And so most of our donors are, you know, people that are middle class, and even, you know, some of the people that are low income, you know, do whatever they can. But, you know, those that have enough to spare, you know, with thankfully, you know, most of the time willing to come and engage them. So, for example, at Christmas time, we invite them and encourage them to come in, not just drop donations and gifts, which we really, you know, very much appreciate, but we want to make sure that they get to know their stories and hear and see them as sort of as people just like them who just happen to, you know, through economic, you know, circumstances, it may be as, and the statistics as you've probably heard is that most Americans are just one or two paychecks away from, you know, from homelessness.
Right.
Right, or poverty. Yeah. And so, you know, these are some of the people we house. Is there, it's not really a stereotypical, you know, when you come into the shelter, you'd be surprised. Some of the people have ran businesses, you know, and some of the people are managers or were managers and, you know, educated and, you know, have some college, if not, you know, if not, you know, a higher level of learning. And then we have those that have substance abuse issues, and that's not really, we wouldn't say that we could pin that on just, you know, on the less educated, you know, because we've had women that have gone as far as a PhD level and have had, you know, struggles with alcohol. And so, you know, we have any number of issues. We're dealing with mental health, substance abuse issues, and, you know, abuse general and domestic violence. But when they interact and hear their stories, a lot of times they come back more often. A lot of times they, you know, some, you know, sort of engage a family and adopt a family, not to take home, but, you know, become Yes. And so it's a reciprocal responsibility on both sides. And when we have, when their churches, our partner churches have things, events that they have, we encourage them to come and ask for volunteer help. If they, if First Press of Evanston, which is one of our, you know, major churches that supports us majorly, we send our, any of the women, our residents, to go and help out in that car wash. And in within the facility, within the center that they live in, we do have a maintenance department, but a lot, you know, we have some women who experience in construction, women that experience in, yes, and so we've had a lot of projects that have been undertaken, you know, that we can't afford. Right. You know, we rely heavily on volunteers as well, but the women have been, you know, real troopers when it comes to, you know, helping to maintain the place.
I think it gives you, well, they say, like, if you give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day, but if you teach him a fish, he'll eat for
absolutely
the rest of his life. So
right,
being
and
able
it,
to
it, it
be
builds
active
their, it boosts their morale,
right,
you know, and when they can, and we, I mean, we're helping them, workforce development means we're helping them find jobs, you know, and then, and if they need training, job training, again, we, it's something that we source out through other agencies that sometimes we're, we get waivers for tuition, a lot of times we do. So they get job training, they're able to get better wages and, you know, have a a livable wage and move on to permanent housing. We want that permanent housing to be sustainable, which is why the second tier is where we focus on the continuum of care. Right.
That's
the
really
additional
interesting
part of that too is, as we're doing all of that, is also, you know, the mission statement is it, we want to end homelessness and hopelessness,
I wanted to ask you,
and all that
that
God brings to us. And so that doesn't just mean the people who come to reside in our buildings, but also the people who are on our board or our staff or other partners, volunteer partners, because we're all in this. We all have needs,
right,
and we all have gifting. God has given all of us something, and so along with that then comes one of the things that we've done under in chaplaincy is we've made a commitment for over the past 2 years where one thing that we hold in common is faith people, be it with some of our church partners or with some of our residents who have great faith as well, is let's come to this place. We're all Christians. How can we grow in this together? So one of the commitments that we've made to each other, they came down during, we were doing prayer walks in the community, and we invited our friends, some of our church partners, and one church that really latched onto that was First Pres of Wilmette. And so out of that relationship, over the past 2 years, we've been intentional about building relationship. And so once a month, we go up to Wilmette, and we have Bible study once a month.
Oh, wow.
And then the following month, they come down to our area and have Bible study with us. So really growing together and,
right,
and being in relationship with one another based on our shared faith in Christ. And so that's one of the ways in ending hopelessness. And then as a chaplain, then part of my duties are around that area of working with especially the residents. And we do that mainly through Christian education and development. So we have Bible studies and prayer meetings. One thing that we're committed to is we pray vigilantly for our donor partners and
right,
our staff partners, all of our partners, resident partners. And then we have evangelism and outreach.
Right.
And we also have crisis intervention as necessary. We've even had to intervene when some people have been tempted to end their life because they felt hopeless. So there have been times when I've been able to talk to individuals and get them to sign what we call a contract for life, where they will have a safety plan where if they're feeling like they're overwhelmed, that they commit to a certain number of people that they will call, that they will agree that they will not harm themselves, but they'll go through this process and get the help that they need and get the support that they need. And that's not just for residents. There's also been volunteer partners who've been in that position as well. So that's another area. And then, of course, working with our community and church partners. And I think Shona alluded to it earlier about that we get public funds, but most of our donations do come from individuals and churches. And so that hopelessness part, you know, you've got to have someone to care and to share and to commit. to a relationship. It's all of, God is a relational God, and He right. calls us to be relational people. And so a lot of ways that we do that ending hopelessness piece is through that. And I can say for myself, it's not, when I first came to Good News Partners in 2005, my mom and dad had just passed. And
oh, wow.
that community really embraced me and gave me and shored me up. I was a youth advocate at the time, but they really loved on me and showed me that love. And so that's what Good News Partners is about, greatly. Well,
I really appreciate you guys for coming and talking to us about this. We only have like 2 minutes left. I know, it just went by so fast.
But really fast.
It sounds like it's just a place, and kind of like what you guys were talking about, it was in college that this started for you and just like all these questions, but someone in college thought, well, I want to be like Jesus. And it all started with Christ and wanting to be like Him. Mm-hmm. And I really think that the approach you guys have with homelessness is really interesting, the different tiers, the different places that people can go, and then they can like do a shelter and maybe in the hotel and then like co-op, and that will help them save for eventually their own place. But even a co-op feels like partly yours.
Mm-hmm.
But is there something in the last like just a minute or so you wanted to say specifically about Good News Partners, or you wanted to share with our audience any help they can give you, anything like that?
Well, we would, part of our fostering, our mission in calls for fostering justice.
Mm-hmm.
And fostering justice means begs the question, how do we live in the richest country in the world, you know, when we have so many people living below poverty level?
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, speaking of being just and being fair, a lot of our partners and donors have stepped up in doing, you know, just that in their contributions and donations. We're very far, you know, from all the things that we need. Yeah, I talked about the, you know, the services that we provide. We have also, you know, healthcare that's, you know, through different streams that we, healthcare, childcare, transportation, many other things we want to provide access to that there's still a great need for. And so churches are not the only place that we look for support. We're looking to corporations and foundations. We're looking to, mm-hmm. you know, Engine 102, for example, you know, in our neighborhood, our very neighborhood have been very supportive, especially around the holidays, and provided, you know, program and financial resources for the women, including presents for the children at Christmas time. So we definitely need more support that mm-hmm. we can allocate to these other activities and programs and therapy, and that we would like to conduct, and to just to help further so fortify the families that we're serving.
Okay, well, I would just like to pray for mm-hmm. your ministry,
sure.
and mm-hmm. then we have a little video about it that we're gonna do after that. So I'll just close us out in prayer,
sure.
and hopefully anyone at home that's interested can go to, what is the name?
Our website is www.goodnewspartners.org.
Mm-hmm.
You can also find us on Facebook,
mm-hmm.
and we also have a Twitter page. So you can call 773-764-9214, and we'll be able to direct you from there as well.
Okay, so if anyone needs help, or if anyone wants to help, mm-hmm. Please contact the lady.
Good News Partners is a faith-based community organization that works to empower our community through affordable housing. The mission of Good News Partners is to end homelessness and hopelessness, build bridges of reconciliation, and work for justice among all people.
Good News Partners is a community-based Christian ministry that focuses most of our work on helping people get housing and develop some capital assets so that they can get out of poverty. Part of our goal is to figure out ways to end poverty, and rather than do it on a big, broad scale, we just try to do it very locally, one family at a time. on the one hand, we try to build our community, helping everyone here know God's grace, God's love, and to articulate with passion and with zest the gifts that each of us has. And on the other hand, we try to build bridges between this community and the supporting churches and communities around us so that together we can figure out, okay, how can we have a just society? That those two combinations of strong community and justice are what we're convinced are necessary if we're going to really do our part in ending poverty.
Good News Partners sees each person as a child of God and worthy of respect. We serve the far northeast corner of Chicago. An estimated 63,000 people live in this ethnically diverse neighborhood. The north of Howard community is a study in contrasts. Families facing unemployment, addiction, and homelessness live in the shadow of renovated storefronts, million-dollar condo conversions, and high-rises.
I think it's all the work of the Holy Spirit, to tell you the honest truth. And then working through the realities of human life, what it takes to be a sustainable community, a community where people have enough income and can take care of themselves and their families. But the work actually comes out of the work of the Spirit in the people that are involved.
Good News Partners' mission is to end homelessness and hopelessness and all that God brings to us, and to build bridges of reconciliation among all people. And so as chaplain, part of my role is to be in prayerful communication with God and help steer the organization in the way that I feel the Lord is speaking for us to affect people that we come in contact with every day.
Homelessness is rare in the north of Howard community because Good News Partners focuses on housing.
We are a big family, and space is really important for us. Good News Partners has helped us a lot.
I like the neighborhood. I think it's the best neighborhood we have lived since we get married and we started having kids.
Affordable housing is a process. This includes emergency interim housing, single occupancy residences, rental housing, co-op housing, and finally, individual homeownership.
Good News Partners provides housing in three ways: welcoming homeless people to either New Life Interim Housing or the Jonquil Hotel, supporting people who are ready to start moving into an apartment but can't afford it in subsidized rental housing, and then co-op housing, which allows people to start working their way out of poverty by saving money through the equity they build up in the co-op, hopefully that they can convert into homeownership or some other good use of their assets.
We were very happy and pleased that we walked with out of the co-op after being 9 years a co-op member. We walked out with about $6,700 in our pocket. We used that money towards the closing costs on this house that we bought. You got no idea how happy we are, and we are been taking advantage of opportunities of this country and this organization have given to us.
In addition to a safe living space, we help residents find jobs, permanent housing, and rebuild their lives.
I'm the rehab manager. We remodel the apartments that our tenants live in. We do plumbing. We knock down the walls. We build new ones. We do floors. I do a lot of training of people. Fortunately, most of our guys have been really curious and eager. I love working for Good News Partners. I really like that I'm working with people who are socially conscious, see the world as a spiritual place.
The Jonquil Hotel is the flagship of the Good News Partners affordable housing program. In 1980, we purchased a rundown hotel at 1600 West Jonquil Terrace. Today, the renovated facility provides affordable, single-room occupancy housing for 130 people.
I came here 4 years ago. I was pretty much homeless, and they found me a place to stay. And in between time, I have put a lot into the Jonquil. I do Christmas decorations, Halloween decorations. When the residents have a birthday, I do all the cooking. I do volunteer work at the front desk. And the rent here is so reasonable. I mean, it's clean, it's quiet. Anything go wrong in your room, they're right there. The same day.
There are people out there for the first time in their lives are feeling the presence of family, support, love, and the possibilities of getting engaged in a society that has not been terribly friendly or welcoming to them.
Good News Partners also manages and owns two additional below-market rental units in other neighborhood buildings. On any given night, more than 500 family members live as Good News Partners in one of our SROs, interim or transitional units, rental or co-op apartments. Housing is only part of the story. Many of our children attend Gale Academy, where Good News Partners reading coaches provide one-on-one tutoring.
The Good News Partners reading program is an intervention program, and we take children from first and second grade that are at risk for reading. The children come every day. We're staffed by volunteers, so the children get one-to-one reading instruction. And I've worked with children all my life, and I especially enjoy working with primary age children. Reading coaches helps children who are at risk.
In our Jonquil youth programs, young people get homework help and test their computer skills.
Just to care for the kids whenever they are out of school, so they're not on the street, they're indoors, they're safe. And so I just try my best and I help with homework, and sometimes we'd share, you know, our feelings and our different experience we have for the day. We just try to love our kids and just try to provide the best thing for them here at this program.
Many of our former residents become our most loyal volunteers.
God is the reason for the founding of Good News Partners, to treat people as we want to be treated and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And in order to love God, we have to love our neighbor. And so by doing that, we fulfill a portion of the scriptures.
I like the community, and since I'm a single person, I think that I would be really lonely living just by myself. So the community's blessed me too. I know that I can always come down for an activity if there's an activity. I can always come down and hang out in the lobby if I wanted to talk to somebody.
This is a place where your life is going to touch the lives of other people, and you're going to be touched by them. You don't have to go to the far distant places of the world to encounter places where God's people really need God's justice and compassion and loving kindness and partnership. And here's a place really close to home that you can cross some barriers that behind which we all live.
So we hope that after watching this exciting and challenging video, you'll desire to get more involved with Good News Partners and God's work here as we try to figure out ways to create justice and end poverty. There are many ways that you can be involved, by getting to work with an individual or a family through tutoring or mentoring, or helping a family make the transition to employment and good housing. And we also really need you to consider how you might be able to write a check for a significant amount of money, maybe even make a sacrifice, so that you can help people who do not have enough economic resources, but who have tremendous potential and assets, have the opportunity to develop those assets and potential so that we together can create a stronger and greater community to the glory of God.
Get up to his with a strong arm. He lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door.